20 Super Nintendo games celebrate 30 years in January 2024. We played them all to separate the gems from the junk, saving you time and money. Here are the top 10 January SNES games. T2, the arcade game, is based on the film Terminator 2 Judgment Day. You play as a reprogrammed Terminator sent back in time to protect John Connor from the advanced T-1000. You use a light gun or a controller to shoot your way through various levels set in the future and the present. Gameplay is simple and straightforward. You aim a cursor on the screen and shoot at enemies, power-ups and friendlies. You have two weapons, a machine gun and a shotgun, with the machine gun having unlimited ammo and the shotgun being more powerful and upgradable. The Super Nintendo mouse, the Super Scope and the standard control pad are all supported. The game is divided into seven levels, each with a boss at the end, and are based on scenes from the film, such as the Future War, the Human Hideout, the Cyberdyne Building and the Steel Mill. It's very faithful to the film and even includes some cutscenes and dialogue. Graphics are impressive, using digitized sprites and backgrounds, giving it a realistic and detailed look. The enemies are well animated and varied, and the explosions and effects are satisfying, capturing the dark and gritty atmosphere of the film very well. Sound is also very good, having a rocking soundtrack that matches the action and the mood of the game, some voice samples from the film, such as Arnold saying "I'll be back" or "Hasta la vista, baby." The sound effects are loud and clear, and the gunshots and explosions are satisfying. The game runs smoothly and without any major glitches, there's no slowdown or flickering, even when there are many enemies and objects on the screen. Hit detection and collision detection are good, making shooting accurate and fair. Some minor bugs include the scoring system being inaccurate and the heads-up display disappearing in some levels. Replayability sadly is non-existent. It's fairly short and easy and can be completed in less than an hour. There are no different settings, secrets or unlockables. The game does have a two-player mode where you can cooperate or compete with another player, but it doesn't add much to the game. It's fun and addictive, but doesn't have much lasting appeal. This is much easier than the arcade version, and most enemies can be killed with one or two shots. You get plenty of health and ammo, and the bosses are not very challenging. There are some tricky parts, such as avoiding friendly fire or dodging obstacles, but they're not very frustrating. It's suitable for casual players and fans of the film, but hardcore gamers might find it too easy and boring. T2, the arcade game, is a decent port of the arcade game, but it's not a great game. It is fun and faithful to the film, but it can be repetitive and too easy. Graphics and sound are good, and it is enjoyable for a short time, but it doesn't have much replay value. I'd recommend for fans of the film and the arcade game, but not for anyone else. Lester the Unlikely follows the adventures of Lester, a geeky teenager who gets stranded on a tropical island after falling asleep on a cargo ship. Along the way, he encounters various enemies, such as crabs, turtles, piranhas and pirates, and tries to find his way back home. Gameplay is similar to Prince of Persia, as Lester can jump, climb and kick his way through the levels. He can also interact with some objects, such as crates, ropes and switches, to solve simple puzzles. There's a total of 15 levels, each with a different theme and challenge. The game can be frustrating, as the controls are not very responsive, and Lester sometimes behaves unpredictably. For example, he may run away from harmless animals, or refuse to jump over gaps. The game also has a limited number of continues, which can make some levels harder than they should be. Graphics are not very impressive, with bland and repetitive backgrounds, small and pixelated sprites, and slow and awkward animations. Lester's expressions and movements are supposed to be funny, but often look silly and annoying, and the game doesn't have much variety in terms of colours, effects or details. The storyline is one of the few original aspects of the game, as it doesn't follow the typical platformer clichés. Lester is not a hero, but a nerd who wants to collect comic books. He doesn't have any special abilities, but relies on his luck and courage. He doesn't have a princess to save, but a friend to rescue. There are some humorous moments, such as Lester's reactions to the enemies and the environment, and some dialogue sequences with the island's inhabitants. Sound is mediocre at best. The music is catchy and upbeat, but repetitive, becoming annoying. Sound effects are generic and low quality, and don't match the actions or the atmosphere. Performance is decent, but not flawless. The game runs smoothly and doesn't have any major glitches or bugs. However, it does have some minor issues, such as slowdowns, flickering and clipping. Loading time between levels can break the flow of the game. Replayability is low, as the game doesn't have much to offer after the first playthrough. There are no secrets, collectibles or alternate paths, no difficulty settings, modes or options, and no achievements, rewards or different endings. The game is very short and can be completed in less than 2 hours. Difficulty is easy but not consistent. Rather than having a learning curve, the game has a random difficulty curve. Some levels are very easy, while others are very hard. Some enemies are harmless, while others are deadly. Some puzzles are obvious, while others are obscure. The game does not have a balanced challenge, but rather a trial and error approach. Lest of the Unlikely is a platformer that tries to be different but fails to be good. It has a unique premise, a humorous tone, and a likeable protagonist, but also has many flaws, such as the controls, the graphics, the sound, and the gameplay, basically everything you need for a decent game. It's not worth playing unless you're a fan of platformers or a collector of rare games. Cannon Fodder combines strategy and action in a humorous and satirical way. You control a squad of soldiers who have to complete various missions in different environments such as jungles, deserts and snowfields, and must use your weapons and vehicles wisely as well as avoid enemy fire and traps. Gameplay is fast-paced and fun, challenging and strategic. You have to manage your squad, which can have up to 6 members, and assign them different roles such as leader, scout or grenadier. Your resources must be managed carefully, which have limited ammo and grenades. Vehicles can be found and used, such as tanks and helicopters, which can give you an edge over your enemy. Graphics are colourful and charming, with nice animations and effects, such as explosions, blood and smoke. There are several types of environments, which are well designed and detailed. However, the graphics can also be a bit blurry and hard to see on a TV screen, which can make some elements, such as traps and enemies, difficult to spot. There's no clear or coherent storyline, but rather a series of missions that loosely follow a chronological order. The game doesn't take itself seriously, and instead mocks the clichés and stereotypes of war movies and games. It does have a dark and cynical tone, showing the futility and absurdity of war. Sound is decent and fitting, but also limited and repetitive, with a few tunes that play during the menus and the briefings. Sound effects include gunfire, explosions and screams. There's also some voice samples, such as the soldiers' names, the mission objectives and the famous "War has never been so much fun" line. The game runs smoothly and without major issues, with a good frame rate and responsive control, but there's some lag and slowdown when there's a lot of action on the screen. There's also some glitches and errors, such as soldiers getting stuck, enemies respawning and objectives not registering. Cannon Fodder has a high replay value with its 24 missions, each with multiple phases and objectives which can take several hours to complete. A two-player mode, where you can play with or against another player, a random element as the enemies and the traps can vary each time you play, and a ranking system where you can earn medals and promotions for your performance. Difficulty level is high, which can be both rewarding and frustrating, requiring skill and strategy as well as trial and error to complete the missions. The game also has a steep learning curve, as it gets harder and harder the further you progress. Permadeath is a feature where your soldiers die permanently to be replaced by new recruits. The game also has some unfair and cheap moments, such as enemies shooting from off-screen, traps being invisible and objectives being unclear. Cannon Fodder is a classic game that is still very enjoyable and playable, with its unique and humorous style, as well as its fun and addictive gameplay. There's a lot of variety and challenge, as well as a catchy theme song and a memorable intro sequence. However, the game also has some flaws and drawbacks, such as the lack of a save feature and the high difficulty level. It's not for everyone, but it is definitely worth a try for fans of strategy and action games. It's a great example of Sensible Software's creativity and talent and deserves a place in the history of gaming. Super Battle Tank 2 puts you in the driver's seat of the M1A2 Abrams tank, from where you complete 16 missions in various desert settings, facing enemy tanks, helicopters, scuds and more. The game is a sequel to Super Battle Tank, which was based on the Gulf War. However, Super Battle Tank 2 covers a fictional conflict over a neutral zone. Gameplay is challenging and requires you to master the tank's controls, weapons and radar. You have to balance your speed, direction and aiming while avoiding mines, enemy fire and running out of fuel or ammo. To destroy targets, you can use the main 120mm cannon, machine guns and missiles. The game has a realistic feel, as you can see the damage on your tank and the enemy vehicles. There are some arcade elements such as power-ups, bonus stages and score multipliers. Graphics are impressive, as a pseudo 3D engine is used to create a sense of depth and perspective. The tank and the enemy vehicles are well detailed and animated, and the explosions are satisfying. Different weather effects such as sandstorms, rain and fog add variety and difficulty. The graphics aren't perfect, however, as there are some glitches, flickering and slowdowns. The storyline isn't very strong. The background of or motivation for the conflict is not explained, with only short mission briefings and objectives being given. But as the focus is on the action and the simulation, the storyline is not very important. Sound is one of the game's strengths, as it creates a realistic and immersive atmosphere with excellent sound effects such as the engine, gunfire, explosions and radio chatter. Performance is decent but not flawless, running smoothly most of the time, but it does suffer from slowdowns and lag when there are too many sprites on the screen. The game has some minor bugs and glitches, such as the tank getting stuck on the terrain or the enemy vehicles disappearing. The performance can be annoying at times, but it does not affect the gameplay too much. Replayability is moderate, offering some incentives to play it again, including three different levels, which affect the number and strength of the enemy vehicles, hidden features such as power-ups, bonus stages and secret codes, and a password system which allows you to skip to any mission completed. Difficulty is high, as it requires you to master the tank's controls, weapons and radar. A lot of enemies are thrown at you, which can be overwhelming if you're not careful. Environmental hazards such as mines, sandstorms and fog can hinder your vision and movement. It's not totally unfair, as you are given some help by way of power-ups, refueling stations and radar indicators. Super Battle Tank 2 is a solid and enjoyable tank simulation with realistic and challenging gameplay, impressive graphics, excellent sound and moderate replayability. There are some flaws, such as a weak storyline, some performance issues and a lack of night vision. The game's not for everyone, as it can be frustrating and hard to master, but for fans of tank games, simulation games and war games, it's highly recommended. Power Lode Runner is an updated version of the classic Lode Runner and features 100 levels of increasing difficulty and a level editor that lets you create your own stages. Gameplay is similar to the original, but with some new features and improvements. You can dig holes in the ground to trap enemies, use ladders and ropes to climb and swing, and push blocks to create paths and obstacles. Some new items have been introduced, such as bombs, keys and switches, that add more variety and strategy to the puzzles. Graphics are colourful and detailed, with smooth animations and scrolling, a cartoon-like style that suits the humorous and whimsical tone of the game, and some nice visual effects such as shadows, explosions and water splashes. There's no clear or coherent storyline, but rather a series of scenarios that loosely connect the levels. The manual explains that Magura-kun is a treasure hunter who travels to different places in search of gold, encountering various enemies and obstacles along the way. The levels are divided into 10 worlds, each with a different theme and setting, such as a jungle, a castle, a factory, and a spaceship. The storyline isn't very important or engaging, but does provide some context and variety. Sound is decent, with a catchy and upbeat soundtrack that matches the game's style and mood. Sound effects are also appropriate and satisfying, such as the sound of digging, collecting gold and blowing up enemies, as well as some funny and expressive sound effects for Magura-kun and the enemies, such as grunts, screams and laughs. The game runs smoothly and without any glitches or bugs. It's fast and responsive, allowing you to move and dig with ease, and it has a save feature which lets you resume your progress at any time. Replayability is high, as the game offers a lot of content and variety. 100 levels of different puzzles and environments, the option to create and play custom levels with the level editor, and a two-player mode that allows you to cooperate or compete with another player on the same screen. The levels have been designed to encourage you to find the best and fastest way to complete them, which adds more challenge and fun. Difficulty is moderate as enemies are smart and persistent, but not overwhelming or unbeatable. You're given enough time and resources to solve the puzzles and escape, but you need to think and act quickly and strategically. A difficulty option lets you adjust the speed and intelligence of the enemies. Power Lord Runner is a fun and addictive puzzle game that is a worthy successor to the original, with a lot of content and variety. It has a charming and humorous style, with colourful and detailed graphics, catchy and upbeat music, and funny and expressive sound effects. Gameplay is simple and intuitive, but also challenging and strategic, requiring you to dig, climb, swing, push, and collect your way through the game. Power Lord Runner is a hidden gem that deserves more attention and appreciation from Super Famicom fans and puzzle game lovers. Brain Lord follows the adventures of Ramir, a young warrior who is searching for the last dragon in the world and, along the way, encountering various friends, foes and puzzles that will test his skills and intelligence. Gameplay consists of exploring dungeons, solving puzzles and fighting enemies, with the game being divided into five main areas, each with its own theme and challenges. Clever, varied and sometimes very difficult puzzles are the main attraction, and you will need to use logic, memory, timing and reflexes to overcome them. Some puzzles require the use of fairies, which are small creatures that can assist you in different ways, such as lighting up dark areas, attacking enemies or revealing secrets. Combat is simple and repetitive. Equipping different weapons such as swords, axes or boomerangs doesn't have much impact, and the enemies are mostly generic and easy to defeat, except for the bosses, which are huge and impressive but also very hard to beat. You'll need to learn their patterns and exploit their weaknesses to survive. Graphics are decent, in a colourful, cartoony style with some nice details and effects, such as shadows, reflections or weather. The character sprites are well animated and expressive, and the fairies are cute and lively. Backgrounds, however, are rather bland and repetitive, and the dungeons are often dark and maze-like. The game also suffers from some slowdowns and flickering where there are too many objects on the screen. The storyline is simple and cliched, but also charming and humorous. The game doesn't take itself too seriously and often breaks the fourth wall or makes fun of the RPG tropes. The characters are likeable and memorable and have their own personalities and quirks. Dialogue is witty and well written, with some unexpected twists and surprises, and depending on your choices and actions throughout the game, there's also multiple endings. Sound is mediocre and sometimes annoying, and the sound effects are generic and of low quality. Although there's no voice acting, the characters have their own grunts and exclamations, which can be amusing. Performance is satisfactory, having a smooth and responsive control system, and menus and interfaces easy to navigate and use. Battery backup is provided, allowing you to save your progress at any time. Replayability is moderate, having about 15 to 20 hours of gameplay. Optional and hidden content such as side quests, secrets and minigames can extend gameplay and add some variety. Its multiple endings can encourage you to replay the game and make different choices. However, the tedious and repetitive combat, the frustrating and obscure puzzles and the lack of difficulty options or modes could discourage any replay. You need to use your brain and skills to overcome the obstacles and enemies, with your efforts being rewarded with achievements, items, fairies and secrets. But mistakes and failures are punished with death, damage and loss of progress. The game has some balance and difficulty issues, with some puzzles and bosses being too hard or unfair, and some items and fairies being too rare or useless. The absence of any difficulty options or settings means the game can't be adjusted to your preference or skill level. Brain Lord is a fun and unique action RPG, with a great puzzle system that will challenge your mind and creativity. It has a humorous and engaging storyline with likeable and memorable characters, but the simple and repetitive combat system will bore and frustrate you. The sound system is mediocre and annoying, causing irritation and distraction. If you're looking for a game that will make you think and laugh, Brain Lord is a good choice, with a lot of potential. You'll either love it or you'll hate it, but it's definitely worth trying. Skyblazer takes you on an epic adventure through a world inspired by Hindu mythology. You play as Sky, a descendant of the Sky Lord, who must rescue a sorceress from the evil god Asura and save the world from its wrath. Along the way, you will encounter various enemies, puzzles and bosses, as well as learn new abilities that will help you in your quest. Gameplay is fast-paced and fun, offering lots of variety and challenge. You can punch, kick, jump, crawl and cling to walls, as well as use different spells that consume magic points. These spells include shooting projectiles, healing yourself and transforming into a phoenix. There are 17 stages, each with its own theme and obstacles. Some stages are linear, while others have branching paths and hidden areas. There's a world map that lets you choose which stage to play next, or to replay any stage you want. The game isn't very long, but it's not too easy, as you'll need to master the controls and the spells, as well as memorize enemy patterns and boss strategies. A password system lets you resume your progress, but the game lacks a save feature or a difficulty option. Skyblazer is a beautiful game that showcases the capabilities of the Super Nintendo. The large and detailed sprites, vibrant and varied backgrounds, transparency, scaling, rotation and parallax scrolling all combine to create a sense of depth and realism, blending fantasy and mythology to create a unique and memorable world. The storyline is simple but engaging and based on Hindu mythology. There's a lot of text and dialogue, adding to the atmosphere and character development, and a satisfying ending that wraps up the story and the character arcs. The soundtrack matches the mood and the theme of the game, and utilizes a lot of digitized sounds, such as strings, percussion and voices, all of which create a rich and authentic sound. Sound effects such as explosions, water and magic enhance the gameplay and the immersion. There's no voice acting as such, just some grunts and screams, but they do add to the expression and the emotion of the characters. This is a well-made game that runs smoothly and flawlessly without any glitches, bugs or slowdowns, even when there's a lot of on-screen action. Stages are loaded instantly, and the responsive and intuitive control scheme makes the game easy to play and enjoy. This is a game you can play again and again, thanks to its secrets and hidden items such as extra lives, magic points and health upgrades, which encourage exploration and experimentation. There's a lot of variety and challenge, which makes the game fun and rewarding. This game, however, is not for the faint of heart, as it's quite difficult and demanding, requiring skill, patience and a lot of trial and error. There's no checkpoints or save points, so you have to complete each stage in one go, which can be frustrating and punishing at times, but when mastered, it becomes exhilarating and rewarding. Difficulty is fair and balanced, giving you enough resources and opportunities to succeed, as long as you're willing to learn and improve. Skyblazer is a hidden gem and one of the best action platformers on the Super Nintendo. It has everything you could want from a game of this genre and is a masterpiece that deserves more recognition and appreciation. If you're a fan of action platformers or if you're looking for a game that will challenge and entertain you, then you should definitely play Skyblazer. You won't regret it. Michael Andretti's IndyCar Challenge is a racing game that lets you experience the thrill and speed of IndyCar racing with a choice of 16 different cars and drivers on 16 different tracks across the world. Gameplay is fast and smooth, with realistic physics and car handling. Various features add to the realism and challenge, such as the weather, the damage, the pit stops and the fuel consumption. It's easy to learn, but hard to master, as you have to balance speed and control and avoid crashing or running out of fuel. Graphics are impressive, with detailed and colourful sprites and backgrounds. Mode 7 is used to create a 3D effect and a sense of depth and perspective. Animations and effects such as the smoke, the sparks and the skid marks are nice, and there's a variety of environments and weather conditions such as the night, rain and snow. Sound is also well done, with realistic and clear sound effects and music. The sound effects include the engine noise, screeching tyres, crowd cheering and the announcer's voice. The music is catchy and upbeat and matches the mood and pace of the game. A voice sample of Michael Andretti gives you tips and advice before each race. Performance is smooth, without any glitches or bugs. The game also has a battery backup feature, which allows you to save your progress and settings, and a password system which lets you access hidden tracks and cheats. Different cars and tracks, the split-screen two-player mode, hidden tracks, bonus cars and Easter eggs all work together for great replayability. The game is challenging but fair, as you have to deal with realistic and unpredictable factors such as the weather, damage, fuel and your opponents. The difficulty setting lets you adjust the level of challenge and competition, and the practice mode lets you learn the tracks and improve your skills. Michael Andretti's Car Challenge is a great racing game for the SNES, offering a realistic and exciting IndyCar experience thanks to its excellent graphics, sound and gameplay. The game is fun and addictive and will appeal to both casual and hardcore racing fans. I'd recommend this game to anyone who likes racing games or who wants to try something different and challenging. Super Pinball Behind the Mask is a pinball simulation game that features three different tables, Pirate, Wizard and Joker, and aims to recreate the look and feel of real pinball machines with realistic physics, graphics and sound effects. Gameplay is simple and straightforward. You control the flippers with the shoulder buttons and can nudge the table with the D-pad. There are three difficulty levels, easy, normal and hard, and two game modes, single play and quest. In single play, you can choose any table and play as long as you have balls left. And in quest mode, you have to score a set number of points on each table to move on to the next one. Graphics are impressive, with the entire table being shown on the screen without scrolling or zooming. The tables are detailed and colourful, with various lights, ramps, bumpers and targets, and the ball is shiny and reflects the surroundings. A storyline is non-existent, it is a pinball simulation after all. However, each table has a theme and a personality, which adds some flavour to the game. The Pirate table is adventurous and swashbuckling, the Wizard table is mysterious and magical, and the Joker table is whimsical and humorous. Sound effects are realistic and match the pinball actions, such as the ball hitting the flippers, the bumpers or the targets. There's also some voice samples, such as the Pirate saying, "Ahoy matey," or the Joker laughing. The music, however, is annoying and repetitive, does not fit the mood of the game, and is the same for all three tables. Performance-wise, the game performs well, without any noticeable glitches or slowdowns. It runs smoothly and responds quickly to your inputs. There's a battery backup, allowing you to save your progress and high scores. However, the game lacks a save feature for the quest mode, which means you have to start from the beginning every time you play. There is some replay value to the game. You can try to beat your own high scores or challenge your friends. There are different difficulty levels which affect the score requirements and the ball speed, and some hidden features and secrets such as extra balls, multi-balls and bonus rounds, which add some variety and excitement to the game. Difficulty is moderate, depending on your skills and the difficulty level, requiring good timing, reflexes and strategy to score high and keep the ball in play. Some random elements, such as the ball bouncing unpredictably or the table tilting, make the game more challenging. Super Pinball Behind the Mask is a decent pinball simulation game for the SNES, having realistic graphics, sound and gameplay with three unique tables and a quest mode. It's fun and challenging and will appeal to pinball fans and casual gamers alike. The game does have some flaws, such as the lack of save feature for the quest mode, the annoying music and the boring and repetitive gameplay. It's not a masterpiece, and it's not a disaster either. It's a middle-of-the-road game that can provide some entertainment and enjoyment. Fire Emblem Mystery of the Emblem is a strategy RPG and the third game in the Fire Emblem series. It covers two parts. Book 1, a remake of the first game, Fire Emblem Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light. And book 2 that continues the story of Marth, the Prince of Altea and the hero of the first game. The game follows the standard turn-based strategy RPG formula where you control a group of units on a grid-based map and engage in combat with enemy units, and features permadeath, where any unit that falls in battle is gone for good, adding a layer of tension and strategy. A weapon triangle system is used, much like rock, paper, scissors, where swords beat axes, axes beat lances and lances beat swords, giving an advantage or disadvantage to certain units depending on their weapon type. A new concept of dismounting is introduced, where mounted units can get off their horses and fight on foot, changing their stance and weapon types. There are 24 chapters in Book 1 and 22 in Book 2, each with different objectives, enemies and terrain, as well as hidden items, secret shops and recruitable characters that add to the game's depth and replayability. Graphics are colourful and detailed, and the pixel art style is a significant improvement over the first game. Mode 7 effects are used to create a pseudo 3D perspective on the world map and in some cutscenes. The graphics create a vivid and immersive atmosphere for the medieval fantasy setting. The storyline is one of the most complex and engaging in the series, spanning two continents, involving multiple factions and conflicts, and exploring themes such as war, betrayal, loyalty, love, and destiny, with many twists and turns. Characters are well developed and memorable, each with their own personality, backstory, and motivation, and multiple endings depending on your choices and actions throughout the game. Sound is rich and varied, with over 80 tracks ranging from upbeat and catchy to somber and emotional, and each perfectly matches the mood and tone of each scene and situation. Sound effects enhance the game's realism and impact, such as the clashing of weapons, the cries of units, and the roar of dragons. Performance-wise, the game runs smoothly and without any noticeable glitches or bugs. Loading times are fast and the menus are easy to navigate. The game has a high replay value, as you can choose to play either Book 1 or Book 2, or both, in any order. Different difficulty levels, ranging from easy to hard, affect the game's challenges and balance, and there are also multiple endings, many secrets and optional content for you to discover and explore. A new game plus mode, where you can carry over your units and items from a previous playthrough, adding to the longevity and fun. The game is challenging but not unfair, requiring you to think strategically and plan ahead, as well as to manage your resources and units carefully. You will be punished for making mistakes or being careless, as any unit that dies is gone forever. Difficulty can be adjusted depending on your preference and skill level, and hints and tips are provided, as well as tutorials and guides to help you to learn the game's mechanics and systems. Fire Emblem Mystery of the Emblem is a masterpiece of strategy RPG and one of the best games on the SNES. It combines gameplay, graphics, storyline, sound, performance, replayability and difficulty in a harmonious and satisfying way and will appeal to both fans and newcomers of the Fire Emblem series, as well as to anyone who enjoys a good story and a good challenge. It's a game that deserves to be played and appreciated by anyone who loves video games.